balance the budget, turn the economy around. And trust me, I know something about how to do that. National security, keep our nation safe. These things were all issues in 2008. We had an out of balance budget, we had a bad economy, and we had a very dangerous world. And yet, that's not why people voted in 2008. Those issues were not on their minds. In 2008, they voted for a vague idea of hope and change. And by ignoring those three problems, they've gotten worse. You heard me talk about the numbers, they've gotten worse. Indisputably, the numbers don't lie. And even today, this week, Congress is not going to do its budget resolution. Now, that's like me not showing up to work. That's like any of us not showing up to work. It's what they do, and yet they're not going to do it. And they've said so. So is the problem that we have this terrible budget deficit, this bad economy, and this debt? Or is it that there's no recognition that this is even a problem in our current leaders? There's no credible balanced budget plan being presented. So we have to change the cast of characters. In November, we have to do it. Now, let's keep in mind, history's a good teacher. In 2004, Republicans controlled everything. And yet, they weren't true to their principles. They started us on a path similar to where we are today. Now, having said that, 2006, the Republicans lost the reins, and the Democrats have doubled down every major problem the Republicans took, particularly on the spending side. 2008, even further. In 2010, it's not about party. It's about leadership. We need to elect people who are going to do the right thing, who have a demonstrated commitment, and the experience to do it. That's what we need to do. The challenge for us all is to figure out who to do that. And my only advice is, you heard me say I'm a father of five. My oldest daughter is, there's three girls before. My oldest daughter is 16. My next child is 14. Another daughter. They don't listen to me very much. In fact, I feel sort of like the voters trying to talk to the Democrats right now, you know, not listening to it. Having said that, one advice that I throw is, when it comes to boys, don't listen to what they say. Watch what they do. And watch what they've done. And I think those lessons apply here. My whole life I've been involved, my whole life, I've tried to make my community a better place. Because at the end of the day, that's what my parents did for me, and my grandparents and people did. They all, very simply, tried to give the next generation, their kids, a better place than they got. We're not doing that right now. We can fix it. We can turn it around. We need to do it together. And we need to keep our priorities very clear. Balance the budget. Turn the economy around. Repeal Obamacare. Let's guarantee a safer, secure nation. I believe I know how to do that. I believe I'm one of those leaders who can be a fresh start. And I need your support to do it. So I'm here to entertain your questions and get to know you all in this process. So thank you very much for having me.
Specific to New Hampshire that I wouldn't apply to the rest of the country, and that is balance the budget.
Okay.
That is balance the budget. The second is, and right along with it, is repeal Obamacare. I believe there's also things that we can... submit two bills at once. Those would be my two bills, a balanced budget plan and repeal Obamacare. I would also, there are things that we can do to turn this economy around that I believe would benefit New Hampshire more than other states because New Hampshire gets it. New Hampshire has always traditionally been an agile, economic leading state. We lead out of the recession relative to our New England brethren. We always do. So I think if we do some of the things that we should have done over the past year, instead of spending nearly $1 trillion on roads that didn't need paving, on weatherization projects, etc., that I think that there were things we could do that would definitely, New Hampshire would be best able to take advantage of. Access to credit and capital in particular, because that's what a lot of New Hampshire manufacturers and businesses lost through no fault of their own, and banks not lending and government own banks. So look, long answer, but that's what I do. Thank you for the question. Sir. I'm sorry. I'm a bad moderator.
Thank you, Mr. Ashford. My question is, as an elected official, you'll be taking an oath of office. As a former military person, I took an oath of office. In your estimation, anyone that takes the oath and does not uphold it, what would your feeling be and what would you suggest could be done about it?
Thank you for the question. I took an oath of office too, and it surprised me. You heard that I went down to work for Gordon Humphrey, and when I showed up as Senate staffer, we all learned that members of Congress need to take an oath of office, but so do their staffers. So do their staffers, and it's not with a lot of fanfare, but I remember showing up to get my badge, and they gave me this little card, and an old Republic was there to witness it, and I took my oath, and it was a both sobering and proud moment. It made me realize why I was there, what I was supposed to do, even though there wasn't, a gallery with pictures snapping. I took it very, very seriously. And the answer is, it's a punishable, fireable offense for everybody. All those staffers that you hear about, they take the oath too. They take the oath too. So we need to hold everybody to account for that.
Do you think that some of our elected officials today are being corrected on that or being punished for it?
They're probably not. Congress is a large human enterprise, and I'm pretty confident, without knowing specific examples, that yes, it's going on, but here's the thing. There is no better correction for bad behavior for a politician than not being a politician. And who holds that power? We're the umpires right here. We get to call the strikes. Carol Shea-Porter, healthcare, didn't go far enough for her. Did not go far enough for her. She wanted a full-out public option. She wants socialized medicine, strike one. She supported this thing called card check, which would change the way unions are organized in private businesses. It would intervene in the current collective bargaining process, to look towards unions, government involvement in business, yet again, strike three. And she's complicit in the budget not being balanced. She is one of those that still spends without limit. No balanced budget plan. Where is her plan? Someone asked her for it. This is her job. She agrees with the policy that they just allowed this week to not consider a budget resolution. Strike three, Willie Elms, she's out.
Hi, my name is Dr. Rollins, I'm from Canada, and this is my first Tea Party meeting.
Welcome.
You talked about having one of your concerns with the national security. Mm-hmm. We have a situation that every time we turn around, there's some sort of a national crisis that it's used as an opportunity to come down more on the American people to instigate more institute more security that actually, I believe, takes away many of our rights. And I'd like to know what your position is on that. Thank you.
Thanks for that.